Well, good evening. God bless you. Hope you're having a great day. I hope this evening is going to turn out great for you with the Word of God. I want to welcome you to home at Higher Ground Calvary Chapel in Riverside. We've got a great service for you tonight. Spoiler alert, we're in the book of Ruth, the second chapter, verses 14 through 23. A lot is going to be happening. Once you turn to that right now, let's go to the Lord in prayer as we would prepare for this service. Father God, we come before you. And Lord, I thank you so much for this opportunity, God, because it is an opportunity. Lord, to open up your word, to have you speak to our lives, to have your word be a light unto our souls. Lord, guide us tonight. Go before us with those who are online now, those who are coming online. Father, just lead us, I pray, as we would get into this study, as we would first and foremost, Father, lift up our hands and worship you. Just praise you, God, with songs of worship. Lord, I thank you for this time now. Lord, be with us. We ask this now in Jesus' name, and together we said, amen. Let's worship the Lord.
Yeah. Close like no other. Good evening, church. God bless, and I hope you're doing well at home. A couple announcements I would like to make. But first, I just want to give a shout out to Pastor Harold and Donna. I was just told that they logged in from Alaska. I know a number of people have been calling in wanting to know if you guys got there safe and sound. And I'm just giving everybody the heads up that you guys are there safe and sound, and our love goes out to you guys. So God bless you. A couple announcements. I just want to let you know about the different events coming up that we're streaming. Obviously, Sunday morning at 9:30, and we're in the book of Ephesians. Now, Sunday, on the first Sunday of every month, we observe communion. So I'm just giving everybody a heads up. It'll give you time to prepare what you need at home to join in and observe communion with us this Sunday at the end of the service. And again, the service starts at 9:30. Next Tuesday night is the School of Ministry. If you haven't been part of that, log in at 7 o'clock. You'll be blessed. If you want to dig deeper into the Word of God, we have two teachers here, Dave Mihirish and Dennis Knotts, both capable men that will take you deeper in the Word of God. Again, that's Tuesday evening at 7 o'clock. Then obviously next Wednesday night, just like tonight, we'll be in the Book of Ruth for our midweek service. Also, a number of people have been calling in again, asking how they can support the ministry. There's two ways of doing it. You can go to higherground.cc.org, and on our website there's a link with PayPal, and you can pay directly with PayPal, or you can send it in through a traditional mail, and the address is Higher Ground Calvary Chapel, 19310 Jesse Lane, Riverside, California, 92508. So again, those are the dynamics about supporting the ministry. Now, the last thing I will close out with, it was still asking you to prayer. We know the whole situation with our stay at home and our lockdown changes almost daily, and we're hoping to get back where we can open these doors and we can see you face to face as soon as we can. But again, we want to make sure that your safety is in mind and we're led by the Lord and when that date is. But it's on our heart that at least by May 31st, we're hoping to open those doors up and to have our Sunday service here on May 31st. And that's not in concrete. We're praying about it and we're allowing God to lead us where we need to be. But we're asking you to join with us that if it's God's will, that he might be able to open those doors by May 31st. Amen. Praise the Lord. And let's get into God's word.
Thank you, Pastor Jack. I've just been online and taking a look and on my cell phone here, and so many people, Donna, Merritt, Ray, Diana, Victoria, Walter, Pastor Harold, again, Victoria, so many others, just clicking in, Viola, Raul, Abby, just a it's so exciting to see the contacts that we have. Even though we can't be together physically, we are here teaching the Word of God, and it's going over the internet, which is incredible. Well, tonight, as Pastor Jack said, we are in the book of Ruth. Ruth, the second chapter, verses 14 through 23. Why don't you join me in a word of prayer as we get into God's Word. Lord God, I would pray that you would go before us tonight. That, Lord, your word, as we open up the pages of the book of books, as we open up the pages of the book, the Bible, the word of God, complete. Lord, speak to our hearts. And go before us and, Father, enlighten our hearts. Father, your revelation to us, Father. And how it has touched our lives, Father, and the inspiration that we get from that revelation. And finally, as we read it, illumination. Lord, help us to understand your word tonight. And may, Father, those who listen and those who watch, Father, speak to them specifically on issues in their lives. I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to do a little bit of recap as we kind of get into this book here. And let me, first of all, these numbers are going to remain on the screen. That's 909-964-0166 and 951-333-1261. Those are numbers that you can text us about prayer requests or anything that's on your heart, anything that's on your mind. We'd love to have you do that. Here we are tonight, Ruth 2, verses 14 through 23. A couple of things we want to share as far as a recap is concerned. The Lord led Ruth to the field of Boaz, as we found out last week, and then led Boaz to visit his field while Ruth was there. Gee, what a coincidence. And I marvel at that, because the reality is simply this. There are no coincidences in the kingdom of God. There are none. None. God lays everything out, and he planned everything meticulously and perfectly, and he certainly did that for Ruth and certainly did that for Boaz. And Boaz, basically, as we talked last week, was a picture of the Lord Jesus Christ in his relationship to his bride, the church. Also, we took a look last week, and we saw that, like Ruth, the lost sinner is outside the covenant family of God, bankrupt, with no claim on God's mercy. That's the prescription. That is the fatal, as they would say, diagnosis. The person that is lost, that is outside of Jesus Christ, they are outside of the covenant family of God, and they are spiritually bankrupt. I don't care how much money you may have in your checking account. I don't care how many zeros you can put on a check. You are spiritually bankrupt. And that's what the Bible says. They're bankrupt, and they have no claim on God's mercy. But God took the initiative, as we talked about last week, and provided a way for us to enter his family through faith in Jesus Christ. And that we find that in Ephesians 2, verses 11 through 13. Ephesians 2, 11 through 13. What you might want to do is, like I say, I love to have a Bible that has a wide margin. Take a pen or a pencil and write that down. Here you are in the second chapter of the book of Ruth. Write it down in the corner of the Bible, okay? Ruth's response to Boaz was one of humility and gratitude. We saw that last week. She acknowledged her own unworthiness and accepted his grace, and she believed his promises and rejoiced in them. Sound familiar? There was no need for Ruth to worry, for the wealthy Lord, Boaz, of the harvest, who was Boaz, would care for her and Naomi. You see where I'm going on this, right? How did she know he would care for her? Remember a little recap? How did she know? Well, he gave her his promise, and she knew that promise could be trusted. Ruth neither looked back at her tragic past, nor did she look at herself and consider her sorrowful plight that she was in. She didn't do that. She fell at the feet of the master and submitted herself to him. She looked away from her poverty and focused on his riches. And you see, so many times for us, we need to do that. Oh, I can't do this, and I can't do that, and I can't do the other thing. Absolutely right. You can't. He can. He can. Hope comes in cans, not can'ts. That's an old saying. It's true. Hope comes in cans, C-A-Ns, not no hope. And so this is where she was. This is what the situation was. She forgot her fears. She rested on the promises, and that was it. And I find that many people, a lot of times, they're miserable because they don't obey the admonition of Hebrews 12:2. You might want to write that down, Hebrews 12:2. And what does Hebrews 12:2 tell us? Well, fixing our eyes on Jesus. Where are your eyes fixed? Where are my eyes fixed? Is it fixed on the problem that looms big in front of me? Man, I don't know how I'm going to be able to get over this or around this or under this. It's just so big. Jesus Christ is bigger than any of your problems. God is bigger than any situation that you could possibly be in. Even right now, in the midst of this virus, God is bigger than a virus. He is. And Ruth trusted in the Lord who was her Lord at that time, representative of Jesus Christ, and his promise to her. She banked on that. And it was absolutely true. You know, people today spend so much time looking at themselves, their circumstances, and other people that they fail to do what Ruth did. And what was that? Namely, center their attention on their master, on Jesus Christ. Center your attention on Jesus Christ. What does the song say? Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face. And the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Yeah. Turn your eyes upon him. Don't just stare at the problem. When you and I stare at problems, you know what happens? They look like they get bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. Okay? Because we're focused in on the problem, on the can'ts. Focus in on Jesus Christ. He can. Absolutely can. Instead of resting in his perfection, people focus on their own imperfections. And they do. You know, how can I do? How can I do this? I can't do this. Instead of seeing his spiritual riches, they complain about their bankruptcies. They do, okay? They go to church, they get their needs met. They go to church really to get their needs met instead of going to church to worship the God who is greater than their need. They've got it in reverse. They need to hear the counsel of that little poem. And what is that poem? Here's the poem. Let me back up here. Look at self and be distressed. Look at others and be depressed. Look at Jesus and you'll be blessed. It's not rocket science. It isn't. Now, that's not pie in the sky and the by and by and that's going to happen. No. If you do that, God has a promise. His promises in his word are this. Trust in me. Put your trust in me. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. What are all the other things? The very first thing I think we all need today is peace. I need peace. in the midst of chaos, in the midst of people running from state to state, going crazy, not knowing what they're doing, people in the park. And I was just talking to Pastor Jack a little bit ago. We have young people in the park that are in their 20s or so. They've got masks on. They're 40 feet apart. They're in a park. This is outside, okay? There's a lot of fear going on out there, a lot of fear. Now, don't get me wrong. We need to do the right thing, and I understand that. We need to have the distancing and all this stuff here. But do you realize these young people, they're not at high risk. It's people my age that are at high risk. And that fear that is generated there is a tragic situation because it causes depression. It causes all kinds of things. Families are, you know, being cooped up and all kinds of stuff is taking place. We should do what we need to do, but always realize this: God is in control. My faith, my life is in his hands. Totally in his hands. What's the old song, the old gospel song? He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got you and me, brother, in his hands. He's got you and me, sister, in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands. So guess what? You know, I could worry myself sick, literally. Oh, what's going to happen? Oh, I don't know about this, and I don't know about that. So I can lose sleep. I can stay up nighttime. Okay? Look at self and be distressed as well as be depressed. Look at others and be depressed. Look at Jesus and what? Be blessed. Be blessed. Let's go on from here and kind of take a look. Let's put in at verse 14. Ruth chapter 2, verse 14, 14 to 23. Starting at verse 14. Now Boaz said to her, I'm reading in New King James. Now Boaz said to her at mealtime, come here and eat of the bread and dip your piece of bread in the vinegar. So she sat beside the reapers and he passed portions, parched grain to her. And she ate and was satisfied and kept some back. A couple of things. Notice how attentive Boaz is to Ruth. You notice it? This is developing into more than just superficial stuff. Now, in that time, people, you know, when they ate a meal, they didn't use forks and knives. I remember being, we had some friends that came from Ethiopia, and we had a dinner at their house one time, and they had a complete Ethiopian dinner, and they would sit down, and basically, they said that dinner could have taken place 2,000 years ago because they had the low tables, although they didn't have tables then, but they had the low tables, and you sat down on pillows. And since there were no forks and knives, basically they used what we would call pita bread, okay, round, flat bread, and all the food was served up through that. You ate that. And they would pass food around in those days. That's why it was very important. When you ate with a person in that day, it said you became one with them, and you literally became one with them. What is the most horrifying thing that happens if we have a gathered together as far as people is concerned, and there's food, and you got chips, and you got dip? You all know where I'm going on this, right? Okay. You know, I got the chip, and the chip is designed to, it holds a lot, right? It's got a little cup in there. You do that, and you bite a half a chip. What's the thing you do? You double dip. Okay, that's all they did was double dip. The whole meal was double dip. And that's why when you ate with a person, you became one with that person, literally, okay? Not figuratively, but literally. It was a sign of friendship when you could sit down with a meal and enjoy it. And this was the situation. They used what they call common bowls, so they had gravy in this one, or maybe vinegar in that one, or something like this. This is what they would do, and they still do it in the Middle East. They still do it. And so this was a common thing. Look at verse 15. He goes on and says this, and when she rose up to glean, Boaz commanded his young men, watch this, saying, let her glean even among the sheaves, and do not reproach her. As we can see, this, again, this kind, this friendship, shall we say, or kindness, is kind of expanding. And he'll tell his workers to let her come right up where they are picking and let her do it, okay? But he also is saying, hands off. Don't touch her. Look at verse 16. Also, watch this. Let grain fall from the bundle, fall prosperously for her. Leave it that she may glean, and do not rebuke her. In other words, while you're picking, just, so we say, accidentally on purpose, drop some down here so that she can pick that up. Yeah, this is what he was doing for her. Look at this. All of this happened to Ruth. Why? Why would this happen to Ruth? Go back with me. What did she say to Naomi? Your God will be my God. Your people will be my people. Guess what she was doing? She was taking an oath to the living God. She was walking out of the godless society that she was in, that worshiped all other kinds of gods, Moabites, to the one true living God. And she took an oath to that, to this living God. You are my God now. And so this happened because of her faith in the God of Israel. That's the reason why it was happening. Boaz fully knew Ruth's story. He did, okay? For it didn't take long for the news to travel in that little town of Bethlehem. It didn't. He knew that Ruth had abandoned her home and her gods, and that she had put her faith in the God of all creation, in Jehovah. She put her faith in that. She had taken refuge, as the scripture would say, under his wings. Now, that image sometimes refers to the hen protecting chicks. And you might want to write down some of these scriptures again. You'll find that in Psalms 91, verse 4. Psalms 91, verse 4. You'll also find it in Matthew 23, verse 37. Matthew 23, 37. But it also refers to the wings of the cherubim in the Holy of Holies. You're going to find that in Psalms 36, verse 7, and Psalms 61, verse 4. I'll repeat that. Psalms 36, verse 7, and Psalm 61, verse 4. Ruth was no longer a foreigner and a stranger, not at this point. She was not only accepted by the God of Israel, but she was also dwelling in the very Holy of Holies with him. You might want to write down Ephesians 2, 11 through 22. Ephesians 2, 11 through 22. Now, next, he is instructing the workers to deliberately let grain fall on the ground. Like I said, notice the intensity of his orders, not to reproach and not to rebuke. Look at verse 17. So she gleaned in the field until evening and beat out what she had gleaned, and it was about an ephod of barley. We'll get into, what's an ephod? We'll get into that in a second. So all day long, Ruth labored, with hope and a hopeful heart. She didn't have a worry about the men harassing her or other people hindering her. She didn't have that at all. She had food when she was hungry, drink when she was thirsty, and a place to rest when she became weary. What is that a picture of? God's provision. God provided for her. God will provide for you and me. I say it over and over again, where God guides, God provides. This is important. And this is also important to take a look at that and flip the coin over. Where God doesn't provide, God's not guiding. This is an important factor in our lives. This is how, and I always used to say, follow where the fruit is. Follow what's happening. If you see fruit in this area here and this ministry is developing fruit and things are happening, then go down that path. If you don't see fruit happening, if there's nothing developing, guess what? God's not guiding. You may want it to happen. Oh, I'm sure that's the situation. Well, if God guides, God's going to make a way. He's going to make a way. But if that's not his thought, if it's not his plan, he's not going to make a way. And then you're on your own trying to push or make a way. I mean, it's like me over here pounding my head against this wall saying, there's got to be a door there. There's just got to be a door there. When actually the door's over there. God provides the door. We get all upset when the door isn't where we want it. Here, God is making provision for everything in her life. Now, the grain that she gleaned, that was an ephod, that's about a half a bushel. And you say, what is that? Okay, that's about enough food for the two women for an entire week. An entire week. I want you to get a hold of that. She also has some food left over that we'll see in verse 18 here. Ruth was not only a diligent worker, but she was also careful not to waste anything that God had given her. And when God puts something in your hand, he expects you to use it. He expects you to, and a lot of times, sad to say, in a younger generation, I'm going to get notes and letters on this one, I guarantee you. In a younger generation, I want it now. I want everything right now. I want it right now. That isn't the way it works. You see, God may give you something small, okay? And, you know, don't neglect the days of small things. If God puts something small in your hand, you work with what God gives you. If God's given you something, and maybe things are changed and everything like this, well, then you work with what God has given you. Work with that, and then let God take care of the rest, and he will. Trust in him, and that's the important part. This is what's happening. Look at verse 18. Then she took it up and went into the city, and her mother-in-law saw what she had gleaned. That must have been something else. She said, girl, you must have been working as fast as could be, okay? So she brought out and gave to her what she had kept back after she had been satisfied. Here's the thought. The word of God and the Son of God can fully satisfy the heart of the believer. The word of God and Jesus Christ can satisfy your heart and my heart. It can. When we see we will find ourselves disobedient and dissatisfied. We'll find ourselves disobedient and dissatisfied. I look to God. Now, don't get me wrong. Other people help people, of course. And it's a blessing to have that happen. But always realize this. The first person you go to when you're needing help is not this way. Not to other people. You go here. This is the first direction. When you go in this direction first, God hears it, then God, in turn, puts that request on the heart of another person, and then that person blesses you. Now, this isn't name it and claim it. I'm not talking about that. But you know what I'm talking about. First, go to God. I've seen that happen in my life over and over again, and I believe you have too. If you've been a believer for any amount of time, you've prayed about something, all of a sudden, something out of the blue, somebody comes up and says, you know, I just felt the Lord put this on my heart, and so this is what's going to happen. Boom. Guess what happened? Your Heavenly Father knows who you are. He knows the situation you're in. He knows the need. And guess what? He says, I'm going to take care of that. I'm going to take care of that through another human being. Now, God can intervene directly, divinely. Absolutely, I believe that totally. But most of the time, if you look through this book, he's intervening through other people. There's direct revelation. There's direct intervention. Absolutely. You can see it time and time again in Scripture. But a lot of times, God uses other people to bless other people. He just does. And Boaz is becoming a blessing to her. Literally. This is what it was. And here's the thing, and I'll repeat this again. The Word of God and the Son of God can fully satisfy the heart of a believer. But when we're seeking it from someplace else and trying to, you know, pull ourselves up by the bootstraps or manipulate or do whatever we need to do, we're going to find disobedience to God, and we're going to find what? Dissatisfaction. We are, okay? Here's the thought. The lost world labors for that which doesn't satisfy. There's your verse of Scripture, Isaiah 55, verse 2. The people that are in the world, that are lost world, they labor for which it doesn't satisfy. They have, they want more. They have, they want more. As human beings, that's a natural trait of a fallen nature. I have, I want more. Yeah, what do you mean? This is an iPhone 6. Now, I think there's an iPhone 10 or probably 11, probably 12 is on the way or whatever, okay? This is all the bells and whistles and goodies. And let's say I trade this in and I get this iPhone 11, which does everything including make breakfast for me, okay? And so I've got this thing, and this is really good. I look at this, oh, man, you know, and you're going to spend like $800 for this thing, probably more, okay? Astronomical amount of money. Yeah, you're really satisfied with this, and this is really, really good, until you see on television what the iPhone 12 can do. Oh, I got to have that. This was good, but that one's better. The eye is never full, the Bible says. Never full. It isn't. We see, we want. What happened to satisfaction? What was it back in the 60s? Well, the Rolling Stones had a song, I Can't Get No Satisfaction. They were absolutely right. You can't really get that kind of satisfaction. Not the satisfaction that fills your soul. Not the satisfaction that gets you go to sleep at night instead of worrying yourself sick about stuff that you have absolutely no control over whatsoever. To be able to hit the pillow and go to sleep because, God, you're in control of my life. I have no control over this other stuff. I have no control of these other people. And you know what? God, you handle it. Good night. And while you're sleeping, God is in control. God is handling the situation. The lost world labors for that which doesn't satisfy. But the believer has full satisfaction because of the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ. Where do you find that? Write down these scriptures. Psalms 36, 7 through 9. Psalm 63, verse 5. Psalm 65, verse 4. Psalms 103, verse 5. Psalms 107, verse 9. Those psalms speak volumes to the fact that the grace, the believer, has full satisfaction because of the grace of Jesus Christ. I don't know about you, but I need grace. I need grace every single moment I'm awake and when I'm asleep. I need the grace of God in my life. I need the mercy of God in my life. As an old hymn writer put it, and there was a wonderful hymn by Clara Williams, put it this way. Let me read it to you. Well of water ever springing, bread of life so rich and free, untold wealth that never faileth, my Redeemer is to me. Hallelujah, I have found him, whom my soul so long has craved. Jesus satisfies my longings. Through his blood, I know I'm saved. It doesn't get any better than that. Everything that you and I will ever have, this, the building, this is a beautiful building. This is a fantastic building. It's all beautiful. But it's not going to last. It's not. I remember the wonderful story that Chuck Smith told. This is back in the, I think back in the 80s, the early 80s or something, and he had a friend who was a car dealer going to Costa Mesa, and the car dealer said, Chuck, he says, I just want to bless you, and what I want you to do is this. I want you to come down. I want you to order whatever you want on the car, and I'm going to get it for you for the exact price that I paid for it. No markup. No markup. I'll pay the taxes and everything, just that. And so Chuck ordered the car, and in those days, it took like about a month or so. They finally got the car, and Chuck got there, and it was beautiful. It was just gorgeous. And he gets in it. It's got that new car smell. It was just a gorgeous car. And those cars in those days back in the 1980s, you could build 10 cars today for the metal that was in that one car. But it was beautiful. He drove it, and on the way home, he stopped at the grocery store. He wanted to get some milk because Caden asked him to get some groceries. And so he goes into the store, and he's just praising God all the way home. Oh, Lord, thank you for this car. Thank you, Lord, so much. I just praise the Lord. I'm so happy. I'm so happy. Goes into the store, comes out, and as he comes out, he looks, and he sees that some person that was parked close to him dinged the side of that brand new car. He didn't have the car more than 1 hour, and there's a ding in it. All of a sudden, all of his happiness just left his body, he said. He got in the car, and he says, this lousy person. Wow, why don't they watch what they're doing? He's just miserable all the way home, and he gets home, and finally goes into the house and everything like this, and his his son at the time, or his daughter, I said, she said, Dad, you got the car? He said, yeah, I got the car. It's out there. And so she goes out and looks, and it's just gorgeous and everything. And she notices the ding in the car. It's a brand new car, so you can spot the ding immediately, right? She looks at the ding, and she goes, what happened there? And he goes, oh, some rotten person. You know, this was Chuck Smith. Some rotten person just banged into my car. He said, man, that's rotten. Why would they do that? She turned around and said, Dad, calm down. It's all going to burn. It's all going to burn. And he told the story. He said he believed that about 20 years later, he saw that same car on a flatbed crushed going to a place that they're going to make new cars out of. It's not going to last. Everything that you see with your eyes, everything that I can touch in this world, all of this, it is not going to last. It is temporal. But the power of Jesus Christ to change a soul, to give you salvation, to forgive you your sins, and for you to spend eternity with him will last for eternity. That's what they call it, eternity. Forever. That's where my eyes should be. Watch, look at verse 19 and 20, and watch what happens now when you see a little change in Naomi. Remember Naomi? She said, her name was Naomi, which is pleasant. She said, no, call me Mara. Bitter. She was bitter. Oh, God, how could you do this to me? How could you do this? My husband died. My son's died. How could you do this? She was bitter. But watch, look at verse 19. And her mother-in-law said to her, where have you been gleaning today? And where did you work? Blessed be the one who took notice of you. So she told her mother-in-law, with whom she had worked, and said, the man's name with whom I work today is Boaz. Verse 20. Then Naomi said to her daughter-in-law, blessed be he of the Lord, who has not forsaken his kindness to the living and the dead. And Naomi said to her, this man is a relative of ours, one of our close relatives. And it's interesting. There's a brand new word on Naomi's lips. I want you to get this. The word is what? Blessed. Blessed. She said it two times in verses 19 and 20. She not only blessed Ruth's benefactor, she also blessed the Lord. We have moved from bitterness to blessings. Bitterness to blessings. That's what you and I need to move to. If there's something bitter inside of you, it's like holding acid to you. You're only going to get burned yourself. Being bitter towards someone else does not affect them at all. It affects you. It would affect Naomi. It's like drinking battery acid. It only eats your insides out slowly. But pretty soon you become so bitter. Let that bitterness go. Turn that situation, whatever it was or whatever it is, over to Jesus Christ and be blessed. Be blessed. When Naomi saw the grain, she blessed the man who allowed Ruth to work in the field. And when she had heard that the man was Boaz, Naomi blessed the Lord. What a change had taken place in her heart. She's a grieving widow, but there was a change in her heart. This change came about because of the new hope she had in her heart. And the one who gave her that new hope was Boaz. And here's the thing. The one who gives you and I new hope is Jesus Christ. New hope. His mercies are new every day. Great is thy faithfulness. Every day you have a brand new blessing from God, a mercy from God. And there's hope every day by putting your hope in him. And like you heard me say before, that's not some fantasy hope or, oh, I hope this is going to happen. No. It's not about my ability. It's about his ability. It's about what he's already done. Look at verses 21 and 22. Ruth the Moabitess said, and you notice how they go back to that phrase? She's a Moabitess. Ruth the Moabitess said, he also said to me, you shall stay close by my young men until they have finished all my harvest. Look at verse 22. Naomi said to Ruth, her daughter-in-law, "It is good, my daughter, that you go out with his young women, and that people do not meet you in any other field." This is important, that people do not meet you in another field. Don't go to another field. Stay here. It's interesting that Naomi, after the bitterness has a way of disconnecting us from God's intervention in our life, God's prompting. Because we're so bitter, we don't recognize the prompting. But when we let that bitterness go, all of a sudden, you notice what's happening? Naomi had a greater connection to God. And all of a sudden, she could see what was happening. Bitterness blinds the person who's bitter. It does. It always does. That's all we could see is anger. All we can see is sometimes rage. Let it go. Let it go. This is what the situation was here. Naomi had hope because of Boaz was a near kinsman who was wealthy and influential. And as we shall see, a near kinsman could rescue relatives from poverty and give them a brand new beginning. You might want to write in your Bible, Leviticus 25, verses 25 through 34. That's where it talks about that issue. Leviticus 25, verses 25 through 34. But she also had hope because of what Boaz did. What he did. He showed kindness to Ruth, and he took a personal interest in her situation. God takes a personal interest in your situation and in mine. He does. He knows what's going on in your life. He knows what's going on in my life. And he's not some impartial God out there somewhere, some fugitive cloud or something like this. No, 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 no. He's personal. He's very personal. And he desires to be involved in everything you do. I love what Paul said. He talks about praying continually. He doesn't mean getting on your knees all day long and just doing this and, you know, or, you know, getting a Bible, going up on a hill and finding a cave and live like a monk. That's not what he's talking about. He's talking about having an attitude of prayer. When you're going about your day, do you have an attitude of prayer? Do I have an attitude of connecting with God? Lord, this isn't working right. I just need your help in this situation. I'm giving God all the credit right here, right now. But time and time again, I've had that happen in my life. And I've just simply just said, Lord, I just need your help right now. And guess what? The situation changed. It changed. It just did. And as soon as it changed, I'm reminded to give him all the glory. God desires. He has a heart of love. That's who he is. God is spelled L-O-V-E, love. He desires to be able to work in you and through you for his good pleasure. That's what the Bible says. But it's predicated on me letting him do that. And anything that would block that, any bitterness, like I keep going back to, like she was, or anything like that, that prevents him from working. Another thing that prevents him from working is a lack of faith. Ruth had faith in Boaz because he promised her things and they were coming through. That's it. How about you? How much do you trust the living God? Look what she did and look what God did in her life. Do you trust him? It's so interesting that when you talk to believers, they say, well, you know, I put my eternal life in God's hands. That's beautiful, but they won't trust him for tomorrow morning. He's real. He's as real as this. He's more real than this. He's real, and he desires to make a change in your life that you've never experienced before. Walking in the Spirit, that's what that's all about. And this is literally what Ruth was doing here. Look at verse 23 as it closes. Excuse me. It says this. So she stayed close by the young women of Boaz to glean until the end of barley harvest and wheat harvest. I want you to check that out. Not just the barley harvest, but the wheat harvest. We're talking a lot here. A lot of resources, okay? And she dwelt with her mother-in-law. Okay, a couple of closing observations. Should not we who believe in Jesus Christ rejoice in hope as Ruth rejoiced in hope? We should. The Bible tells you and I need to rejoice in hope, okay? When you consider who he is, what he's done for us, I'm talking about Jesus Christ, and what he says to us in his word, there is no reason for us to feel hopeless. We feel hopeless sometimes because we look at situations that are out of our control. It is built into our DNA as a fallen person to want to control. And right now, the frustration is we have no control whatsoever. But here's the situation. God says, I am in control. Stop beating your head against the wall. Let me handle it. Rest in me. When was the last time that you rested? And I mean really rested. I'm talking about your soul, your spirit, your mind. When was the last time you really rested? Or are you grappling with things that you have no control over whatsoever? And maybe I'm speaking to someone right now who is going through that situation, who is fit to be tied because there's something or someone or some situation that you're going through and you don't know how to handle it. Let God handle it. One of the what they would call Chuckism, he always used to say, let God fight your battles. He will do a much better job than you will ever do. Let him fight your battles. Don't try and fight it. Let it go. Let God handle it. That's not being naive. That's not being stupid. You need to do what you need to do. But when the things are outside your ability, what are you going to do? Let it go. God always does the heavy lifting part of your problem. You and I do the light lifting. We'll do a few things here or there. God says, okay, you finished now? Yeah. Then God rolls up his sleeves and he says, watch this. Watch this. I was talking to Pastor Jack before and I said, and it's like in the, here we are in the situation. He had Moses, had an ocean in front of him. He had mountains on his sides and had the Egyptian army behind him ready to slaughter every single person there. He finally looked in the right direction, that way. I can't handle this. What am I going to do? What did God tell him? Stand still and watch. What did I give you? You gave me a stick. Hold it out. What God puts in your hand and in your life, he wants to use. He wants to use it in ways you will never imagine. He was using this young woman, this young Moabite, to be able to do something so incredible. You say, what was that? What was she going to do? Follow the lineage from Boaz and Ruth all the way to guess who? David. All the way to guess who? Jesus Christ. Centuries would go by. Centuries. But God's plan is perfect. We can't understand it. We can't wrap our head around it. I just say, Lord, by faith, I accept it. I accept what you have for me. And this was it. When you consider what he's done, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, has died for us, and now he intercedes for us as he was interceding there. In his word, he has given us what they call exceeding great and precious promises. Where is that? 2 Peter 1, verse 4. 2 Peter 1, verse 4. And those promises never fail, okay? No matter how you may feel today, wherever the situation that you're in, and we're all in one kind of situation as far as this virus is concerned, no matter how difficult your circumstances may be, you can rejoice in hope if you will focus your faith on Jesus Christ and not on the problem right in front of you. This is what he says, and he means it. For the Christian believer, hope is not a shallow, hope-so-filling, generated by optimistic fantasies. It's not. Hope is an inner sense of joyful assurance and confidence as we trust God's promises and face the future with His help. This is what He says to you, and this is what He says to me. I want you to do this, and I'm going to be there with you. I'm going to be there with you through the entire thing. I'm going to take care of it. Don't worry. There are some people that just have to worry. If they don't worry about something, they don't know what to do. What's the phrase we use? A worry wart? Or a worry wart? Do we know worry warts? We all know worry warts. There's got to be somebody who just gets up in the morning and goes, I don't have anything to worry about. Got to worry about something. Okay? Sure enough, guess what? If you look for a problem, you're going to find a problem. Okay? Let God handle it. Here's the thing. This hope is God's gift to His children through the Holy Spirit, who reminds us of God's promises found in His Word. That's Romans 15:13. I want to write that down. Romans 15:13. Here's the bottom line. Ruth's half bushel or ephod of grain was the first fruits of all that Boaz would do in the future, just as the Holy Spirit within us is the first fruits of all that God has promised us. I want you to get that. I'm going to say it again. Ruth's half a bushel, really, was the first fruits of everything that Boaz was going to do, just as the Holy Spirit, or the down payment, as we talked about before, the Spirit in us, is the first fruits of what God intends to do with you and I. Grab a hold of that. If you didn't hear one thing I said tonight, hear that, okay? And here's the other thing. Although Ruth's supply of grain would be gone in 1 week, it'd be gone. The witness of the Spirit within will remain until our hopes are all fulfilled when we stand face to face with Jesus Christ. That's a promise from God in His Word to you. Tonight, I hope you were able to see the blessings. I hope you'd be able to grab a hold of the fact that Naomi, she went from bitterness to blessings, that Ruth was blessed because she put her trust and faith in the living God. And I encourage you tonight, right where you're at, put your trust and faith in the living God. I want to pray with you right now. And maybe there's a person that is out there that is watching or listening. And you want to know, well, how do I do this? So do I join a church? You can join the Marines. You can join the Army. You could join the Navy. You could join the Air Force. You could join the Coast Guard. You could join the Boy Scouts or Girl Scouts. You have to be born into the family of God. You say, how do I do that? By turning your life over to Jesus Christ. By simply saying a prayer. And I want to lead you in that prayer right now. You're going to say it to Him, not to me or to the other people, wherever you may be. Just, if you want a relationship with Jesus Christ, the living God, just as Ruth, thousands of years ago, she put her faith in Him. Repeat these words after me and mean it in your heart. Just simply say, Dear Lord Jesus, I know I'm a sinner. Forgive me my sins. Cleanse me. Wash me. I repent of my sins. I want you to be my Lord and my Savior and my God. If you've done that, and if you've said those words, the Bible says if you put your trust in Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit has come in and He dwells inside of you. He dwells inside of this fallen body. And the Bible says now you need to follow Him. And if you just did, you need to get a Bible. If you don't have one, you need to get one. You can get New King James or, you know, a lot of different translations that are out there that are very, very good Bibles. But most important of all, I'm going to come around here and I'm going to move this mic so that you can hear me. Most important of all, you need to find a good Bible teaching, preaching church and get in it. And I'm not talking about taking up space in a pew when we all come back into the building. No. I'm talking about being involved. Being involved in things regarding the church, maybe contacting other people that we could do right now. You can contact people. That's what these numbers that are here for. That number right there, 909-964-0166, 951-333-1261. You can contact other people. You can reach out to other people. Don't be isolated with a problem that you may have. If you've turned your life over to Christ, now that problem belongs to Christ, and guess what? So do you. But you need to have other people around you to encourage you. And that's what these numbers are for. I pray this message has been an encouragement to your heart. I want to pray for you right now. Heavenly Father, I thank you for the men and women who were signed on tonight. I pray, Lord, that you'd be with us now. Father, as we would rest this evening, that you would guide and provide. And Lord, that you would touch the hearts of the men and women that were watching here tonight, that our hope is in Jesus Christ. Our hope isn't in a government. Our hope isn't in a governor. Our hope isn't in a president. Our hope is in the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and his name is Jesus Christ. He owns it all. Owns it all. Lord, I pray a blessing on the people tonight. I pray, Lord, that you would bless them in their going out and they're coming in and they're rising up and they're sitting down, that, Lord, you would touch their lives. I thank you for watching tonight, and I pray with all of my heart that you'll be blessed. Please tune in this Sunday at 9:30. Tell a friend. We're excited about what God is doing here, even in this kind of contact, and see what he does. God bless you. Have a great night.